In other news, Credit Suisse's chairman apologizing to shareholders for the bank's collapse and rush takeover by rival UBS. Security was tight and check-in was slow for some 1,750 shareholders who showed up at the hockey stadium in Zurich for the bank's first in-person annual meeting since COVID-19 and its last before the 167-year-old Storde Bank is taken over by UBS. Protesters gathering outside the venue, with some erecting a capsized boat to depict the bank's demise.
We wanted to put all our energy and our efforts into turning the situation around. It pains me that we didn't have the time to do so, and that in that fateful week in March, our plans were thwarted. And for that, I am truly sorry. I apologize that we were no longer able to stem the loss of trust that had accumulated over the years, and for disappointing you. And I would like to apologize for that.
In other news, a defiant Donald Trump pleads not guilty to 34 criminal charges in the first ever criminal arraignment of a former U.S. president. Trump is accused of violating election laws through a scheme to block the publication of negative information about him ahead of the 2016 U.S. elections. He allegedly paid two women to suppress their accounts of sexual encounters with him, adult film actress Stormy Daniels and former Playboy model Karen McDougal. Following his arraignment in Manhattan, Trump returned to Mar-a-Lago and delivered a speech denouncing the charges against him.
As it turns out, virtually everybody that has looked at this case, including rhinos and even hardcore Democrats, say there is no crime and that it should never have been brought. Even people that aren't big fans have said it. They said this is not the right thing to do. It's an insult to our country, as the world is already laughing at us for so many other reasons, like our open borders.
The only crime that I have committed is to fearlessly defend our nation from those who seek to destroy it. From the beginning, the Democrats spied on my campaign. Remember that? They attacked me with an onslaught of fraudulent investigations.
And former Senate President and real estate mogul Manny Villar is still the richest man in the Philippines. That's according to Forbes' 37th annual ranking of the world's richest. Villar's net worth estimated at $8.6 billion, or around 467 billion pesos for 2023. On the global list, he also climbed more than 100 spots to 232nd place. Villar is followed by port magnate Enrique Lazon and San Miguel boss Ramon Ang on the Philippines list. Rounding out the top five are Henry C. Jr. of the SM Empire and Emperador owner Andrew Tan, who share a spot on the Forbes list with a rank of 1,217. As for the richest in the world, there's a new king in town, as Bernard Arnault, the head of luxury goods giant LVMH, or Louis Vuitton, unseats Elon Musk in first place. This after Musk's pricey acquisition of Twitter dragged his net worth to $192 billion. Meanwhile, Forbes also notes nearly half of all billionaires are poorer than they were a year ago, citing falling stocks, wounded unicorns, and rising interest rates. In other news, the Philippine Supreme Court upholds its earlier ruling giving jurisdiction over the upscale Metro Manila Business Center, Bonifacio Global City, or BGC, to Taguig's local government. The High Court's Third Division denied an appeal by the Makati City government. The decision was actually reached back in September, but was only made public on Tuesday. It comes after a years-long dispute between the two cities. The Taguig local government calls the ruling a new chapter for the city, but Makati's legal officer says they have filed another motion for the Supreme Court en banc to hear the case. Attorney Don Caminia says the ruling will affect not just businesses, but the access of residents to social services as well. Speaking of the finance secretary, Finance Chief Benjamin Jokno, who used to head the seven-man BSP Monetary Board, reiterates the BSP has probably done enough to tackle inflation, suggesting the end may be near for the BSP's tightening cycle.
Post lang muna, di ba? And then look at the situation. Kasi monetary policy works with a very long lag, 9 months. And ang laki na lang in-adjust natin. Let it, hindi pa na-absorb ng system yun.
Meanwhile, Jokna also not too worried about the OPEC Plus group's surprise decision to cut daily output by 1 million barrels starting May.
Oh God, just kagad. 1 million lang hindi masyado. Kasi ang threshold nga namin $90 per barrel.
The finance secretary also saying that the Interagency Committee on Inflation and Market Outlook, or the IAC-IMO, convened this Monday and came up with a list of strategies to streamline data gathering tools that can help mitigate inflation. These strategies include tapping advanced technologies such as satellite imagery to analyze demand and supply of key commodities. Also on the list is the Philippine Rice Information System, or PRISM, which is an operational system for nationwide rice monitoring that identifies the scale and magnitude of production gaps in rice. While the project Smarter Approaches to Reinvigorate Agriculture as an Industry, or SARAI, will provide agricultural stakeholders with site-specific advisories on crop forecasts and yield estimates, as well as assessments of droughts and availability of rainfall in order to mitigate climate risks.